Donald Trump spoke to the UN General Assembly today, where he used the opportunity to hammer home his priorities for the country.
Our goal is simple. We want balanced trade that is both fair and reciprocal. The future does not belong to globalists.
In other words, he did the exact opposite of what 16-year-old Swedish activist Greta Thunberg demanded of world leaders during yesterday's climate summit.
People are suffering. People are dying. Entire ecosystems are collapsing. We are in the beginning of a mass extinction, and all you can talk about is money and fairy tales of eternal economic growth. How dare you? The eyes of all future generations are upon you. And if you choose to fail us, I say we will never forgive you.
Trump clearly did not get the memo, probably because he spent only 15 minutes at that summit, just long enough to deliver this little tidbit.
I'm a big believer in clean air and clean water.
I assume that's why his administration announced earlier this month that it was ending protections for millions of acres of streams and wetlands. So, after a worldwide climate strike on Friday and a worldwide UN summit yesterday, is there hope? I'm joined by former EPA administrator under Barack Obama, Gina McCarthy. She's now director of the Center for Climate Health and the Global Environment at Harvard's Chan School of Public Health. And she's just back from the climate summit as well, where I'm told she did stay a little longer than 15 minutes. That is correct, isn't it?
Yes, I did.
Okay, so big, nice to see you, by the way.
Good
huge
to see you
climate
too,
weekend. But let's go in chronological order. I know you were at the climate strike in Boston. What was your reaction when you saw the photographs and video from around the world, millions of people led by kids?
I just thought it was great. I mean, it just gives you a sense of how concerned young people are and how much they're going to demand of all of us that we have to step up. My favorite sign was, if you won't act like adults, we will.
I love that. How about No Planet B? I love that one, too.
It's so good. But, I mean, it's good, and it's also a reminder that, you know, young people are really worried right now. They know that this is about science, not a belief system. And they know that clean air and clean water is directly related to the climate challenge.
You know, I would argue they're not the only ones that are worried. There was a guest on Fox News who referred to Greta Thunberg as mentally ill. He was banned from the station. But interestingly, not banned from the station was Laura Ingraham, who apparently is also nervous, who likened Thunberg to a murderous child cult leader from a Stephen King story. I assume even deniers act that irresponsibly when they're nervous that the walls are closing.
Yeah.
Is that not a fair statement?
I think it's fair to say that people in the United States are getting it and people across the world know it, and we have to do something about it, and they're going to deny it until the end of their days.
Optimists about Friday, the climate strike, suggest that there will be a parallel to the Parkland kids and guns, that their relentlessness, the teenagers there, is what really has caused this gun reform effort, both in state capitals and possibly even in Washington, to have more of a shelf life than it had before. Do you share the same optimism?
I'm an optimist on this issue because I believe in my democracy. Mm-hmm. I believe that when the federal government abandons things, people speak from below and they push and make demands up. You know, Jim, there's a lot of reason to be optimistic.
Well, I'd like to hear one thing other than Friday.
Well, there's a lot going on in cities and states, including across this state. There's a lot of things happening on the health side that begin to make us understand that climate change isn't a faraway thing, it's a today thing. And there's solutions that will bring lots of benefits to us economically, jobs. We are talking about change that's good for us, not change we should be denying and holding.
When you said a minute ago, when I first talked to you after you became head of this thing at Harvard, I'm going to paraphrase because it'll probably get you in trouble, but I think it's close to right, is less about the polar bears on the ice caps and more about your neighborhood. I mean, that's essentially your mission, to bring it home. Right?
That's exactly right.
And is there any hard evidence other than your optimism that people are getting it? I mean, I thought when CNN had whatever it was, 42 straight hours of town halls on climate, it was actually 7 hours, which I thought they're playing to an audience that is beginning to to exist. That was a good sign to me.
Yeah, well, that's a turning point. I mean, I can remember the days when there'd be a presidential election and would think of it as real success if one of people running mentioned climate change. Now they're actually using words like climate crisis and they're talking about it. It's the first step, Jim, but it's a big one.
Speaking of first steps or a step, is there any evidence that what happened on Friday had any impact in around the world, had any impact on what happened in New York City on Monday? Because from what I understand, I mean, I read, for example, a summary of a report from, I think it's the World Meteorological something or other, talking about how the 5 years since the climate accord was signed, five hottest years in history, and that the climate targets have to be tripled to be able to achieve the goals of. So, and my understanding is some traditional outliers, the Chinas, the Indias, et cetera, did announce increased targets. I mean, good targets, yes?
They did. But, I mean, we all know there needs to be more. But that really, honestly, Jim, we all know that without the United States not just sitting there but doing something and providing world leadership, we're not going to get where we need to go as fast as we have to. But, you know, I attended these meetings on the side with world leaders standing up and wondering, what is going on with the United States? If we join this, if we have a president that provides leadership, we will get there.
But you used to talk about standing up. I was mystified. But originally, we had been told the president was going to boycott the climate summit in New York City. And then he went. And I just said he was there 15 minutes. You corrected me and said he was there for 14
minutes.
Okay. Was that purely to sort of flip the bird at every other world leader? Why? What was the point of this show and then walkout? For a dramatic turn or something?
I have no idea why he actually does anything. And so maybe he was there to listen to Prime Minister Modi, who was speaking, because he seems to want to develop a relationship with him.
India, yeah. So, by the way, you told me a while ago that tradition when a cabinet member leaves is to reach out to his or her successor offer your help. You never got a call back from Scott Pruitt. Scott Pruitt is long gone. What's the guy's name? Wheeler, who's now the coal
Andrew
guy
Wheeler.
From the coal industry?
Yes.
Is there anything good happening on his watch?
Well, I think, again, and I had this discussion with Wheeler.
You have talked to him?
Oh, I did talk to him because he reached out to me and asked if I wanted to come into the agency and hang up my portrait, which I wasn't able to do with Scott Pruitt. Well, we never kind of wanted to cross paths with one another, and he never left because of his travel problem, Scott Pruitt. So Wheeler said, come on in. And I told him, how am I doing? I said, well, your big problem is you work for a president that doesn't like your agency, and he's going to be
How did Wheeler react?
And he said, well, you know, we'll work these things out. And you know, so Wheeler has marching orders. He is, you know, dismantling that agency. He's tearing up the science. It's not inconsistent with the work that he did for Senator Inhofe for a long time.
Who's
and as a lobbyist for oil and gas.
Inhofe is the one who said it was a hoax. Yeah, he's the one that created
right,
the hoax.
That's right.
Can I bring something else? Yeah. We only have a minute left. Bill McKibben, who obviously started this whole thing in 1989 with the End of Nature, was on the radio show with us today. And, you know, he wrote the cover story on Time Magazine's special climate issue. Yeah. It's called, his piece called Hello from the Year 2050. We avoided the worst of climate change, but everything is different. Here's how McKibben described 2050 on our show today.
I mean, if we do everything we can do now, we can't stop global warming. It's too late for that, but it may not be too late to stop a warming so great that it cuts civilization off at the knees. We have to go to work really hard now.
Do you agree with his assessment?
I agree that it's a challenge, and I know the world has changed and we can't take it back. The only thing I disagree with is the tone. You know, if you have a long race to run and your future is at stake, I am not going to start out by telling myself I can't make it. I am going to be talking about the things we can do already that will get us to 100 yards, that'll get us to 5 miles. And I'm going to tell everybody, because we can do it, that we're the United States. We innovate, we move, we run, we rule the world, and we make this happen. That's the only way we're going to do it,
Jim. And by the way, that tone was assuming that Donald Trump was not reelected, according to Bill McKibben. Gina McCarthy, keep doing it. It's great to
Thanks.
See you.